This week's episode of the Breach Report, we cover the Saudi Aramco data breach. This breach is a little different from the recent spate of ransomware attacks, and it's not ransomware, and it's debatable whether or not it's a cyber extortion attack. So to get more into that, we'll cover what we know so far about the attack, how it happened, who's responsible, the type of data that was stolen, and how organizations can avoid becoming victims of a similar type of breach. To start off with, Jason, tell us a little bit about Aramco.
Yeah, Aramco doesn't need too much of an introduction. It is the largest oil and natural gas producer in the world, with revenues of about $229 billion reported in 2020. They actually had one of the largest IPOs in 2019 at a record $2 trillion. And you know, it's interesting when we talk about this attack and we've talked about previous attacks, we know that natural resources are a prime target for threat actors. And Saudi Aramco is also no novice to experiencing these types of attacks. People might remember the Shamoon attack perpetrated by Iran in 2012. Cutting Sword of Justice was the threat group at the time that claimed responsibility for the attack that compromised about 30,000 workstations and caused suspension of services for the organization for several weeks. And so, you know, you kind of touched upon a really interesting thing about us not knowing about whether it's a ransomware attack or extortion attack. Can you talk a little bit about what exactly happened with this attack, Josh?
Sure. So first of all, Aramco didn't even know about a breach until a terabyte of their data had been leaked online. We have an image of kind of an overview from Bleeping Computer here of some of the stuff that they managed to take coming up. So they denied that it was from their systems that they were breached. They said third parties were scraped for data or possibly breached, and that's where the data was taken from and put up for sale.
Okay. Yeah. And so in your mind, is this potentially a proof of concept?
I don't know. It's an interesting attack because, yeah, they didn't really, as far as we can tell, you know, they didn't actually encrypt anybody or ransom anybody or anything like that. So, you know, maybe it was a proof of concept, just trying to find out what data is available publicly. And, you know, maybe they didn't have to try that hard. You know, maybe something else is going on. You know, there's like, you know, maybe some kind of piggybacking activity or something else. One of the things that we'll talk about too is what really kind of caught my attention in this is they put a little bit of a puzzle in there and said that, you know, Aramco has a certain amount of time to, you know, do something. So in my eyes, that's what kind of makes this an extortion attack. It's not a ransomware. Nothing was encrypted. Aramco services are still running. And as far as we know, so are their third parties. But, you know, they are selling it and they are saying they'll delete it if Aramco buys it. And they've sent them this interesting little puzzle, as I said. So, yeah, we'll kind of dive into, you know, how they're extorting Aramco, right?
Okay. So can you tell me about the type of data that was breached?
Yeah. Everything. So it was full information on 14,254 employees, very specific number. It's names, photos, passport copies, email, job title, residence permits for their different countries they live in. And then on the technical side, there's project specifications for systems, you know, power, architectural, engineering, internal analysis reports, agreements, letters, pricing sheets, network layout mapping. So they have IP addresses, SCADA points, Wi-Fi access points, IP cameras, and IoT devices. So a lot or everything you possibly need about, you know, a network. Location map of precise coordinates of where all these SCADA systems are and lists of their clients along with invoices and contracts. So some very sensitive data.
Wow. So they literally have access to really everything, how the organizations run their network map, like you mentioned.
Right.
So now let's talk a little bit about who is responsible for this attack.
Yeah. So if you pull up here, we've got a front end. This is the sale site on one of these leak sites that sells breach data. And if you look at the username, it's 0x269259. I can't quite read that. So ZeroX is the group, though. They're the ones who are claiming that they did it. And this is a new group. They're rather unknown. You know, I talked to a lot of sources that I have, and nobody really knows a lot about them. And I couldn't find much in research. So, you know, nobody else really been attack by them as far as we can tell.
Okay. And can you talk a little bit about how the attack itself happened?
Yeah, so this one's interesting. It's not a ransomware. They didn't hit Aramco. What Aramco says is these guys went and scraped for data off of their third-party vendors, right? ZeroX themselves actually spoke to Bleeping Computer, and ZeroX is claiming that they actually used 0 days to breach these systems. So they did, in fact, attack these third parties and steal the data out of sensitive areas there. Neither of those stories has really been proven one way or the other yet. So, you know, whether this was just a scraping attack or they did, in fact, you know, break into some companies, still kind of up in the air.
Right. And so what do we know about the extortion payment terms so far?
So they post the information online for $50 million for sale. Now, before that was posted up on the page, this is where the puzzle comes into play. And there's a screenshot of this puzzle here at about 408 hours. So they gave them 662 hours, right, on the sale, right? And that equals 28 days. But it doesn't really say anything else. There's just a timer on there. And when Bleeping Computer spoke to ZeroX about it, they just said, oh, that's a puzzle for Aramco to figure out. So I don't know if they're just trolling like 28 days later. You know, I mentioned earlier, you know, maybe they're piggybacking on something. You know, maybe they saw somebody else in their system or like, you know, think this is bad, just wait. Who knows? Could just be messing with them, you know, trying to put the pressure on them to get them to sell.
It's such an arbitrary number, though. 28 days, that's not a lot of pressure, right? You know, if you said, like, here you have a week to give us
right.
The money, maybe not.
Yeah. Well, so talking about that pressure a little bit, this kind of gets into where we're at now, which is, you know, they're saying they've already got buyers. They have this countdown. Now, the assumption is this countdown is when it's going to go publicly for sale, because right now it's like a private sale, like kind of like on auction. So maybe that's what it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, you know, we've seen all of these attacks, the demands, not just, you know, ransomware, but just demands in general from these threat actors are just increasing. We talked about this with Kaseya, the $70 million ransomware for the master of the crypt key. And, you know, JBS Meats for several millions of dollars. I think they ended up paying $11 million for that. So, you know, the threat actors are emboldened for sure. And so what can you tell us about the current status of this attack?
So as of July 27th, it's kind of still where it was. The data's up pending sale. ZeroX, as I mentioned, have 5 potential buyers. Now, I didn't give any details about this and whether or not it's true, right? It's something else. It could just be, again, another thing to pressure Aramco into paying this $50 million. But if they do have 5 potential buyers, you know, it gets kind of interesting. Who could those be, right? It could include, you know, state-backed threat actors. Maybe Iran, again, would be interested in it. Really, for anyone, this is a great way to collect the data on Aramco while keeping your hands cleaner, right? As you're not the one who did the breach. You're just buying stolen data. So it's... you know, it is a good industry. People do pay for this kind of information. And the info they have on Aramco here is, you know, you could use it for all kinds of things. If you wanted to run some kind of phishing or other social engineering or even a penetration campaign against them with all this information about their network and their people and these pictures. I mean, you could go and put together a really great campaign against Aramco with this data.
That could potentially yield a lot more. That's a really interesting point, selling the data to other threat actors who might want to run their own campaigns. Kind of begs the question why they would reach out to Bleeping Computer to take responsibility for it other than for kind of making a name for themselves.
Well, it's just that. I mean, we've talked before about it being business now. I mean, it's dark web business. They're fully fleshed out businesses. And so part of that is advertising. I mean, who are you, ZeroX? Why should I pay you $50 million for a data dump you claim is somebody's, right? So if you know, they make headlines, then people are paying attention to that just like we are, right? So that's useful there.
That's also a very good point too, because, you know, when you go to some of these hacking conferences, you see these people showing off zero-day exploits. And
right.
You wonder why. It's like you could get, you know, $100,000 for that. You can easily get 6 figures for some of these exploits. But it's not about selling that particular exploit. It's about creating relationships, because now we know that this group is able and capable of doing this much damage to such a highly established organization. You know, who else out there is going to start reaching out to ZeroX to hire them to run campaigns against completely different organizations?
Right.
So yeah, maybe that gets back to the proof of concept that we were talking about.
Yeah, it's all about that MRR, even for the criminals, you know?
Right, exactly. So, you know, one of the things that we'd like to do with Breach Report is to offer some actionable advice here. So what can companies do to prevent this type of breach from happening to them, Josh?
So there's a couple layers and steps that you can do. And each one's a little bit more difficult, but a little bit more effective. But first and foremost is doing third-party vendor assessments. It's not necessarily going to prevent this type of breach, but it will help you better understand your risk through third parties. And this needs to be a really good practice. It's not just, you know, do you have a certified, you know, ISO 27K or whatever. You actually need to find out where's your data going on their networks and do they protect that? Which brings in the next step, which should be done. And really, you should all be done in tandem, but you kind of have to build a program, right? Especially with the limited ID budget. So knowing your data is huge. Now, you assess your third parties, but do you really know what kind of data you're sending to them? And are you sure that they don't have access to data they shouldn't have? So data inventory and data segregation on your network will really help out with that. So if one of these third parties does get breached, you're not like Aramco where they've got everything from passport photos to IP addresses to geo-coordinates of SCADA systems, you know, mm-hmm. you can kind of limit what they can pull out of your third parties.
Yeah, and you know, to touch upon the vendor assessment component, at PurpleSec, a lot of the times we get clients who come to us who say they need like a penetration test or something. And a lot of it is either compliance driven. I mean, compliance kind of runs security in a lot of cases these days, which, you know, you just check a box doesn't mean you're actually secure. Or it's, I have a client that wants to do business with me and they want to know whether or not I'm secure. So they're asking for us to prove by doing a penetration test. And in a lot of cases, these organizations haven't even done that assessment step. Like they don't have a CIS top 18 control list, or, you know, if there's compliance, underlying compliance, or NIST frameworks or any of that, they don't have any of that. So they're just saying, we need a pen test, how much? And the problem with that is, well, if you don't have anything established, we're going to go in there and we're going to wreck your system in a couple hours or maybe even minutes in some cases.
It's not cost effective.
It's not cost effective. And really, what's the true value out of it? So, you know, the assessment bit and really the long-term strategic strategy of your security and your program, like you mentioned before, building that up and maturing it. That seems to be much more, return on your investment of security.
Yeah, so that gets into the last bit, which is my favorite thing to talk about, zero trust. Zero trust is right now kind of the ultimate goal of really security, I think, and it should be, especially for stuff like this. So zero trust goes the further step in limiting the actual splash damage that a threat actor can do, meaning, you know, if they impact one system, how many other systems can they take out with them, or how many can they collect data from with them? So zero trust turns every single thing into its own environment, right? So, and then it has its own perimeter, and then you have your own rules per perimeter. Now, if that sounds complex and complicated to put together, it is. It's difficult. It requires you understanding your network inside and out, and it requires eliminating a lot of technical debt in the organization. But the thing with zero trust is, while it's a lot of upfront, lift and resources and all forms of resources, right? What happens is you, down the road, get all of that back, because now you're maintaining a lot less. You know, you're not necessarily going to have to pay for as many third-party vendor solutions. You know, defense in depth plus zero trust is the right way to go, but you can maybe, you know, cut out a little bit on your depth if you've got zero trust in there. And then if you know, the worst happens and one of your third-party vendors or even you yourself get breached, it's not going to be able to completely own your entire network. It's only going to be able to completely own whatever you let those things talk to.
Right. And, you know, there's a reason why you and I think we try to keep reiterating on zero trust is because it's where the security industry is heading. We've seen this with the Biden executive order after the Colonial Pipeline was hit, that all of the U.S. Government agencies are moving towards zero trust, or at least they're creating frameworks to eventually move to talk about moving to zero trust, however it's going to pan out. But we see this in really all aspects of security. Is if you walk down, the level of access that individuals or companies have, and you're not having wide trust against, across three or four different companies, like in the case of the Kaseya breach when we talked about that. We're an MSP, you trust Kaseya, we trust your program, and we're going to send it off to our clients who automatically trust us, and then all of a sudden you have 1,500 companies being ransomed. So, yeah, I think that, zero trust is going to be the way forward. So, kind of going back to the Saudi Aramco breach, is there anything else that you wanted to cover here, Josh?
Not at this time. There's still some information out there that is pending. This is one I'm definitely going to be curious about following, at least in my own time. And maybe if something interesting comes out, we can do some follow-ups on it, depending on how that pans out.
Yeah, I think one thing's for certain. I think ZeroX is definitely a threat group that's going to come out of the surface again. They're going to start taking credit for other wide-scale attacks. And, speculation, but I think it might be a bit of an advertising campaign and look at what we can do. So
right.
We'll see what happens. All right. Well, thank you so much for your time. I hope that this was valuable to you. Please leave us any feedback on how we can improve. And until next time, thank you.
Thank you. It's been the Breach Report with Josh and Jason.